Varsity Football men's competition has been concluded, except for the final, which will take place next Thursday. The women's competition gets underway in Potchefstroom over the next 3 days, with the semi-finals taking place on Saturday. So four matches for all of the teams involved here. There are playoff matches, there are semi-finals, but we start with the group matches. And the first up today is the Tshwane Derby that comes to Potchefstroom in the Platinum Province. It is the University of Pretoria Tucks up against the Tshwane University of Technology. Nothing quite like a Tshwane Derby to get things underway as far as varsity football for lasses is concerned. It's a different format from the men's competition as well, because the men have a single group of eight teams, and they play each other each once. Seven matches there involved. As far as the ladies are concerned, two groups of four teams each. They'll play three matches in the group stage and then one match in the playoff matches as well. That's on Saturday. So one match today, two matches each tomorrow. And chatting to the coaches, they feel, yeah, it's a bit hectic because they're going to have to rest players. They're going to have to change players up and really turn things around, and makes it a bit of a challenge. And then into the knockout from the pool matches on Saturday, it brings a different format into the situation as well, because knockout football is completely different to the group stages. We pause for the national anthem. Africa's national anthem before we get underway with the first match of the 3 days of women's varsity sport football live in the World of Champions. Thanks for joining us this afternoon as we go through the competition this afternoon. We won't pick up the matches tomorrow or on Saturday, but we will have the ladies' final on Thursday afternoon live for you at the TUT grounds on the western side of Pretoria, just before the men's grand finale between the two Gauteng Giants in UJ and Tshwane University of Technology. So the side then from the western side, that is TUT, the two-time defending champions, beat Tucks by 5-0 in the final in 2014, and they beat the University of the Western Cape in Cape Town just 12 months ago by 2-1 to pick up their second championship. So looking for a hat-trick of titles here are the Tshwane University of Technology. No pressure on Teboho Mokai. Did say, though, that they were looking forward to winning the title for the third time. That is the Tuck side then, coached by Sipiwe Dludlu. And you know about Sipiwe Dludlu. She's been involved with Tucks for quite a long time. You've heard her as an analyst as well upstairs here on the odd occasion on varsity sport football in the gents competition. We worked with her up in Mafeking in the first round, where the University of Johannesburg beat Northwest University Mafeking by 6-2 in that memorable match, I'm sure that you will remember. So the two teams then greeting each other in a friendly fashion. It's the red colours of TUT, the white of UP Tucks. There's the starting lineup then from Tucks. We'll start in goal with Andrea Sumaraj. It's a formation that Sipiwe Dludlu looks to attack a lot. She's got Shannon Morgan and Tanya Oliveira up front, and then some wing play as well. Two holding midfields in Makura and Kwaba. That's how they'll line up then in the tactical formation, with Morgan playing just behind Tanya Oliveira, and some width offered as well by Michael and Lina. There's the coach of the Pitak side, Sipiwe Dludlu, former Banyana player in her own right. So the Tshwane University of Technology side, coached by Teboho Mokai, started Petronella Chuluwane in goal. Almost a 4-4-2 combination, but they do start with one holding midfielder and then an attacking midfielder and two wing players as well. Mashilwane and Manamela will offer the width. We've got the attacking midfield in Sabati, and Mashilo and Madiba will start up front for the two-time defending champions. They know each other quite well to decide from TUT. It wouldn't be any great surprise, I think, if they manage to get through into the semi-finals. Don't forget, two groups of four teams each, and the top of each group will play the runners-up in the opposite group come Saturday in the first of the knockout rounds before we get to the final on Thursday afternoon up at the Tshwane University of Technology. So final warm-ups for Tux, and they are our refereeing panel, all ladies there as well. Lindiwe Twala with Tandukazi Pakhleni. Maneo Tao is the other official, and Diatle Malepane is the fourth official for this one. Mbakang Mbatla is the captain of UP Tux. There are some interested spectators that are coming into the stadium. Not much in the way of fans out here in Potchefstroom, but it is the middle of the afternoon on a Thursday. We do anticipate maybe towards the evening game, which is UWC against Northwest University Pukka Potchefstroom, that the fans will come into the stadium and really support the Northwest University side. The last in the picture there is Lebogang Rakudwe. So, referee Lindiwe Twala set to get us underway. A last little huddle for the University of Pretoria Tux before we get this one underway. I must say, it's quite a blisteringly hot afternoon in Potchefstroom. A strongish breeze blowing in from the northern side of the stadium, so it'll benefit one of the sides in the first half and then the other during the second half. And it's a wind that will be assisting, not to play diagonally across the pitch. Andrea Sumaraj is the goalkeeper for the University of Pretoria Tux. As we get underway with Varsity Sports Football, the women's competition on your World of Champions today, it is the University of Pretoria Tux in the white, TUT in the red. Good to have you with us today. And let's have a look to see the entertainment that the Lasses will bring to us. As we said, back in 2014, TUT beating Tux 5-0 in the final. Got to bring into play Mogan Inda, who used to play at TUT back in the day, 2013, made the semi-finals against Nelson Mandela Metropolitan University at home. He played as a goalkeeper. He's my analyst today, Mogan Inda. Hello and welcome.
Thank you once again, Kevin. I'm really looking forward to a thrilling top eight tournament right here at Porch.
Yeah, it's going to be a good one. The first free kick by Maputi Manemela for the Northwest University, just going a bit wide of the target. They do play with the wind with them during the first period here to the University of TUT, that is. Here is Andrea Sumaraj kicking into the wind, and opting to go out wide onto the right-hand side with Matlakala Mahoa. Mahoa almost losing out immediately again. Maputi Manemela getting herself involved in the play early on. Koketso Klailana is the left-sided fullback for TUT. Just looking at the teams warming up, I did get the indication. I felt that TUT looks a little bit more animated between the two sides. Here's Lebogang Rakudwe. She is playing in the pocket for TUT, the holding midfielder. To where is the captain's armband as well. Nicely poached away in the middle of the park by Vuyela Makura for UP Tux. I can tell you as well that the ladies' game is 35 minutes for each half, the 15-minute halftime. So don't expect to see the ladies out there for 90 minutes. It's 70. But a stoppage time at the end of either half, probably. Bit of a foul throw there from UP Tux, looking to get themselves into an advantageous position early on. Mo, have you had a look at the ladies in previous years in the varsity net football?
Well, Kevin, besides the varsity football, the team meets so many times in Pretoria because they're both based in Tshwane, so they know each other very well. Today the stakes are very high. Somebody wants to remain number one and somebody wants to leave with the 3 points today. So definitely these teams are looking to just get the back of the net. Obviously Tux with the new players and TUT keeping some of his old players is definitely going to play a huge role. And the team shouldn't be afraid of each other, I believe. They're ready to take on each other as opponents in Poch.
It's quite an interesting format as well. It's a ball get played through here again by Maputi Mashilwani. A chance at the back post and the keeper's come off her line. She makes a good save. Still an opportunity here for Bontle Mashilo. They're living dangerously already, our Tux.
They seem to be flat-footed at the back. It was just that the keeper came out on time. She couldn't handle the ball and she really tried to stop it with her body. Fortunately, it did not go in as a goal. They flat-footed. If you look at that, the keeper just came out and then she couldn't handle the ball. She tried again and then she blocked it again, which is good for Tux. Then they can regroup and start focusing on their centre-backs, trying to focus on the game.
Corner kick already taken the first of the game. There's opportunity from just outside of the penalty area. And again, a mishandle by Sumaraj almost presents the opportunity for Sebati. Looking for a first touch is Tanya Oliveira. Plays it wide to Shannon Morgan, the two strikers. There's a bit of width off it as well by Pamekwanati Mtuna out on the left-hand side, but the ball never gets to her. That's an interesting format, Mo, because in the men's competition you play seven matches. So even if you drop points at some stage, you have an opportunity to recover. In this format where you're only playing three matches before you get to the semi-finals, the opportunities are limited there. But because if you lose one, maybe draw another, that's just about the end of the competition for you.
That's true. You definitely need to get the 3 points in each and every game that you play so that you maintain number one. And then you are the finalist. Definitely you're going to play the finals in Tshwane. So it's a different format. Yes, it is. But the teams really need to score goals and get to remain number one.
Rachel Sapati holding up the ball rather nicely. Has a little dart in the defense. Nicely worked away, though, by the centre-back, Sinusen Norris. Out wide here to Koketso Tlailana, who's a left-sided fullback, but she's way over the halfway line and she looks quite adventurous, does Tlailana. Half an hour to play before we get to first half stoppage time. Just to remind you, 35 minutes aside, Tlailana knocking the ball onto the inside, away by Koketso Mahlangu. UP Tux just making a little bit of progress down that far side. UP Tux men's side lost a last round match against Wits University, which prevented them from making into the semi-finals. The men's side unbeaten in the competition. They'll play in the final on Thursday evening. In the men's final, will TUT make it a TUT double in the women's competition? That would be awesome for the home side because the finals are being played at the Tshwane University of Technology. Wonderful sporting facilities out there on the western side of South Africa's capital city. Again bursting through there is Sapati, looking for the left-hand side with Manamela. Lovely play again, and Tlailana getting involved in that as well. Across the penalty area, knocked away though by Norris. Not much coming back from UP Tux at the moment. Maybe just playing a watching brief. Full aim towards Tanya Oliveira one more time. So far, to the pressure being exerted by TUT and Petronella Chilwani, the goalkeeper for TUT, yet to have a touch in the game. All away by Vuyela Makura with her interesting long braid hairstyle. Long throw in from Lebogang Mabatle, and there's absolutely no hesitation coming from TUT. They want to get that ball forward as quickly as possible. They want to utilize the wind to their advantage as well. Lina losing out to the midfield of TUT. Here is a first touch for Chilwani. Just to be careful with her first touch. They're not quite finding a rhythm early on here, are the University of Pretoria Tux just yet. That's in your picture. Is Shannon Morgan. Certainly TUT look as if they play together for a little while and they've settled down the cricket of the two sides, which isn't a great surprise. But we still level at 0-0. Sadly, Petronella Chilwani has had a couple of touches, looking for the flick on, knocked away by Mabatla for Tux. forward now, looking for Mdlina. Just got himself into a little bit of a muddle there. But it looks like Mahlangu will make the clearance for TUT. That's a nice little turn as well from Manamela. She's been quite influential so far in the opening 7.5 minutes of this encounter. Makura trying to stop Mashilwani from getting the ball away. But now they do have possession. A little bit wayward from Ladakho Madiba. I thought she was trying to have a shot from 40 meters out, Madiba.
It looked like that, definitely. Unfortunately for her, she couldn't just connect with the ball and just hit one of the opponents in the legs.
A bit of a miscue at the back from UP Tux. Maklaka Mahoa, the right-sided fullback, and is he going to be kept in play or go to play on for a goal kick? It is a goal kick for the Tux side. And again, look at the ground being covered by Koketo Tlailana. She's been mighty impressive because she's covering a lot of ground. She's the left-handed fullback. She finds herself almost on the goal line. There's the coach, Tebogo Mokae. Know the man?
I know Tebogo Mokae. They call him Coolio. He's the coolest coach you've ever met.
Well, William Chongwe is the coolest cat at Supersport on air in football matches, the former Swazi international. And we've got the coolest coach here as well in Tebogo Mokae. It's all happening. Ball picked up again by Rachel Sabati. Goes into the midfield with Rakuduwe. Rakuduwe really holds the ball up rather nicely. Closed down there by Tanya Oliveira. And a bit of punching there from the two Tux strikers allows TUT to work it back into the middle to Rakuduwe. Sabati back to Rakuduwe. Look up there and looks for some options. Finds it in Mapana. And more adventure coming from the fullbacks. I must say, they play quite a high line, the fullbacks here for TUT. Unfortunately, just a little look up from Mapana sees the ball slip under her legs.
It looks like Koketo Tlailana and Lentsi Mopana are going to play a very different left-back and right-back situation right here. They'll be pushing too deep and trying to just get those crosses. If you look at Tlailana, she's not really a left-footer, but she's there at the left-back. Definitely, they trust her left foot, which means she can rip in those crosses.
It'll be interesting to see if there is some organization that comes from the University of Pretoria Tux and if they can exploit, just get behind the fullbacks of TUT if they push forward. Once the fullbacks are over the halfway line, it's the responsibility of players like Rakuduwe and Mashilwani in the pocket to drop back and try and offer some cover, and maybe the central defenders as well. The ball through the middle there, chased on for Sabati, that goes behind. It's a goal kick. I think TUT were hoping for a corner. Assistant referee points for a goal kick. The referee points to the corner. I think the referee will have the final say on that one.
He definitely gets the upper hand when he's made the decision. Unfortunate, the assistant ref did not pick it up, and the ref maybe may have seen the last touch from the UP player.
So second corner kick of the game then. There is the assistant referee on the near side. Tandukazi Bahleni. This is Manamela. Mine is the call, but it came from a Tux defender. Comes back to Manamela. Distribution hasn't been that bad today, so space on the back post, flicked away by Makura. Still an opportunity, cleared off the line by Tux. They're living vicariously here. And eventually the ball is scraped away by Zinisa Norris, but still a chance. Again, there's a despairing dive this time from Lebohong Mabatla. How long can Tux hold out against this really resurgent looking TUT side? Great passage of pressure coming from the two-time champions, and applause from Lebohong Rakuduwe.
It looks like Tux is giving them room. If you look at the TUT players are open on their own and they're taking shots, and Tux are just trying to defend the goalpost more than they should be closing down their opponents on time, and then they can be able to win the ball in time. There, if you can see it there, they're just taking shots, and UP is definitely pulling away from them. They're just blocking the ball and they're not closing the opponents or marking them on time.
Well, the benefit of that sort of play is that most of those shots looked as if they were on target anyway, so they're going towards the goal, number one. Number two, in the crowded penalty area, all it needs is for somebody to stick out a hand and the referee points to the spot, so there's a whole lot of benefits to that. Numbers forward, banging in shots, they all look as if they're going to be on target. There's another opportunity with a header that goes wide. And another opportunity created by the Tshwane University of Technology, and balls coming from the Tux defense for being able to survive another scary moment. But how much longer can they survive in this sort of mode? Ladakho Madiba with a second opportunity. Don't forget, she tried to score from 40 yards out a bit earlier. Wasn't able to do that. Forward by Alexandra Michael. They're just going to stand on the ball for me and try and just pop it in behind the defense of TUT, the Pretoria Tucks side. Kwaba looking for a way through and an opportunity for Mahoa. Just not the same quality of touches that you're seeing from TUT in the Tucks side, is it?
It's not really happening for UP. They seem to be just throwing the ball into the opponent's half and trying to get there. They cannot have a combination play. They cannot pull a style of play just for them to counter TUT. So they'll definitely face difficulties when it comes to the final third.
Well, that's the second foul throw-in that we've seen from the University of Pretoria Tucks. We're only 13 minutes into the first half, so they'll want to tidy up on a couple of spots around the edge of the pitch at the moment, and Sipiwe Dludlu will no doubt be making notes of what needs to be done as far as tidying up is concerned. At the moment, they need to stand on the ball and do something constructive, the way TUT are doing at the moment. All worked away by Vuyela Makura, and it'll be a free kick to Tux as well, with Kailani throwing herself into the fray. I think the lass who's down there is Shannon Morgan. Might need a bit of medical attention. In fact, that's Alexandra Michael. It's a one-on-one ball, really.
It is definitely a 50-50 contact. It's just that Kailane stuck her hand out and then she contacted the other opponent, which is resulting to them having to lose the foul.
So free kick for the University of Pretoria Tucks. I think it's their first of the game. Nice little hanging ball on the edge of the penalty area, which is a good idea. Stand forward now, looking for a chance here. Curling ball knocked in by Mdina. Shannon Morgan also had a chance in the D of the TUG penalty area, and suddenly they had players forward in that area. They're playing as a stiffish breeze, though. Tucks, maybe the ball just pulled back towards the lasses and they weren't able to adjust in time. Yasebati wide to Manamela. Nice little ball from Manamela. It's a little short passing game. I was just wondering for a moment if Peter Mosamani wasn't in charge of TUT.
It looks like everything that is done in Tshwane is starting at Sundowns. You know, Peter Mosamane likes those short passes. And definitely, Tebogo Kulemukai came to this game trying to challenge UP Tucks with those short passes as well. Maybe they can find something.
Three corners to TUT in the opening 15 minutes of the game. All from the near side. Maputi Manamela, away is the call. Head into the back of their own player from TUT. Trying to scramble it away to safety. Makura leaving it to Kwaba. So now the fullbacks are pushed forward a little here with Mopana. Is there a little bit of space available for Oliveira? Nice little tuck inside. Maybe a little bit of hesitancy from Papalo Lepele, but eventually the clearance comes from TUT. All over the park, TUT looking a better side. They have 60% of the possession in the first 15 minutes of the game. A little skill there from Manambela, who finds Rakotuwe. They seem to have a nice understanding in the middle of the field for TUT. Nice clearance that from Lebogang Mabatle for Tux. And a bit of an adventurous looking shot there. You can't blame them, TUT, they got the wind behind them.
It's definitely the wind favoring them and they're just hanging the ball up there. Unfortunately, they couldn't catch the keeper off guard. She was just in position and she couldn't handle the ball very nice.
Here they come again, an opportunity to get around the keeper, the first touch. He's too strong from Madiba.
Just over 16 minutes gone and the score remains goalless.
But in survival mode here are the University of Pretoria Tucks and a second missed opportunity.
Look, it was a good run for Madiba. She just poked the ball too much and the keeper had already committed. Had she just pushed it a little bit, it would have been something different, but then she poked it too much and then she couldn't follow it up and then tap it into the back of the net.
Yeah, she knows it. Just needed the smallest of touches. Tip in the midfield here by Shannon Morgan. Looking again for Dina. Makura beaten to the ball by Rakudue. Now wide to Mapana. The goals from TUT, really, when they get the ball, they're immediately looking up for an opponent to play to. Nice little angles and triangles being shown here by Taboko Mokai's side. And things very much under control. They haven't scored yet, but they're certainly looking like a side who could grab a goal at any time as the tidying up is done again by Zinis and Oris. Nice to see how well prepared the pitch is here at the Northwest University of Potchefstroom. At the Fani de Toy Sports Complex. Lots of stadiums around here. There's football fields, there's a big cricket oval, gymnasiums and rugby fields. Yeah, it really is a terrific event. But I must say that having been to a lot of the universities around South Africa, the facilities available to the students are incredible. Of course, there have been some issues in recent times, but yeah, that's part of the developing and growing up and we're getting there as a country. Rakaduwe goes through the middle, tucked away by Mabatle. Kailane not able to find a teammate down that left-hand side for TUT. Pretty Manamela's down there. You've got Madiba who popped over to that wide side just for a moment. Again, the clearance comes, this time from Mabatle. It's just complete damage control from Touch right now.
They just need to defend their keeper the best way that they can. And I'm happy that the defense of Tux are really trying to just keep up with the attack that TUT is bringing to them. They're trying to get the balls, always intercept the ball, take them away from TUT.
We'll scramble back here by Zidisi Morris. Picked up nicely there, though, by Bontle Mashilo. Mashilo looking for a little bit of support and finds it as well. Manamela with a chance across the face of goal. And again, the first touch isn't a great one from Matiba. Something to work on always in any profession that you're involved in.
It's a matter of communication. Matiba, had she laid the ball for Bontle Mashilo, who was just right standing right in front of her, could have been something different.
The tuck inside by Mashilwani. Again, the shot doesn't have any great power on it from Matiba. She's getting into the right area. She's just not getting her foot behind on the final touch. Is Letago Madiba. I just want to hypothesize on something as we head up towards the 20th minute mark in the first half. What if this match is level at nil and at half time? Suddenly in the second half, Tux have the win behind it. Does it change anything?
Look, with the style of play that Tux is playing, they just want to take the ball on their opponent's half. It could work to their advantage because they can just pump the ball into the opponent's half and just try and press up TUT. Then they can get a goal and maybe then from there they can defend.
Maybe they play that old style route one sort of ball, and any balls that are close to their penalty, just as you said, bang it down the field of play and look for the chase from Oliveira, Morgan, Lina, and Michael. We'll see how things pan out. They do have an attack at the moment. The clearance away by Rukuduwe. Touch there as well from Rachel Sabati. Now they come on the counter attack. It's a lovely ball as well. Matiba's got some work to do out wide. Does have support in the middle from Mashilo if she can get the cross in. Does get the cross into Mashilo. I think the offside flag was up first, but Sumaraj makes a great save anyway. Her positioning's been great. She hasn't got the best hands, Sumaraj, but her body positioning's been terrific.
That's all you need when you keep up. Be in the right place at the right time and always put your body behind the ball. If you can see there, Madiba had the ball. She just made a good turn and then she just went to lay it over. It was already offside.
Well, maybe that wasn't quite necessary in that case, but yeah, the fans love it when there's a bit of skill being shown on the pitch. And maybe players like Talbot Okale and company, that player Squama from Barocca, has had some influence on the women's game as well. 20 minutes in to the first half of the opening match of the women's competition at Varsity Football 2016. Don't forget, each half is 35 minutes, so only quarter of an hour remaining. Touch-up crunch out from Alexander Michael, who was playing on the right wing, pops across to the left for the moment. Still they give possession away, as does Maputi Manamela. Still all the pressure coming from TUT. Touchback here. How many passes has Rakuduwe been able to implement from that sort of midfield position? Really has done well. Appeal for a handball here. Nothing from referee Twala though. The ball not able to reach Tanya Oliveira. Kailane. Nice control from Kailane. Again, she also tries a little bit of a step over. Good work done by Sabati. Will Sabati have a crack? No, she goes back to Manamela. Manamela's been quite a good feeder of the ball. That's a nice challenge at the back as well from Mojadibe for WP Tux, but here's Mana Mela one more time. That goes over the crossbar.
Mana Mela has done all the job that she needed to do. She just needed to be composed and maybe whipping that beautiful cross into the 18 area.
The next match is UWC against Northwest University. Paka UWC with the losing finalists in 2015, losing to TUT by 2-1 at home. And they play in Group A. This is a Group B encounter, by the way. The University of the Western Cape will play the home side, Northwest University, Paka Potchefstroom, in the late match, where Grant and Timber will take you to that 70 minutes. It's a nice little touch through the middle. A chance for Zepati. Goes across to Mashiel Wani. Still, they're not getting the touches where they need them. And again, they've been caught offside. So the creativity's there, just that final little discipline and the look across at the line must give some sort of benefit and a credit to Tux for that.
It's good credit we give it to Tux. Definitely they're trying to just push forward and just catch TUT on offside. Obviously TUT doesn't want to add numbers on time on the box, and the balls that they are playing with right now, they're definitely going to miss them towards the end of the game when the game is still 0-0.
That was always going to end up in a free kick to Kutso Mojadibe. The referee taking the time and blowing for it.
If you see there, Kuto, she had already won the ball, but they just grabbed each other and handled each other to the ground. That's why the ref decided to judge the foul against TUT, because the leg was on top of the Tux player.
Headed away by Lancy Mopana. These sort of positions is where the running should take place. That's three foul throw-ins in 24 minutes. It's ridiculous. From the same side. Understand the urgency to get the ball back in play, but these are basics over here. Return from Bontle Mashilo. She goes out of play as well. It's going to be interesting to see. It's very, very warm indeed. And tomorrow, all of the teams are going to play two matches in this heat of the Northwest Province. We've had some temperatures around late 20s and early 30s around this part of the world as spring comes into full force. Last thunderstorm down in Bethlehem last night would have brought a bit of relief to the Golden Gate National Park. We'll head her through now, but nobody following up, and protection for Sumaraj comes from her centre back, Lebohang Mabatle, who is the captain of the side. Morgan doesn't keep it in play.
Tanto seems to be just wanting to take the ball on the opponent's half and then try and find something to do in that half and protect their half the best way that they can, because TUT is bringing it to them.
Zepati now suddenly from the left-hand side, and again it goes over the top of the strikers. Shilo and Madiba not able to pick up the ball there for the Tshwane University of Technology. And I wonder how long they can continue to create these sort of opportunities that land up being goal-scoring chances and missing them, and that doesn't affect their psychology at some stage.
It definitely affects the psychology.
Mashilo, ball in the middle of the penalty area, the behind the header, which goes out nearly for a throw-in on the corner flag. So Rachel Sabati with an opportunity on that occasion.
This was a beautiful cross. All she had to do was just jump a little bit higher and put it on the chest, control it, and then maybe take a nice, beautiful volley in, could hit the back of the net.
I tell you what, I thought she just launched her head towards the ball a fraction late. By the time she was hitting the ball, it had arrived big on her, almost like a cricket expression where the batsman gets surprised by a bouncer from a quick bowler. So she was caught a little bit by surprise there, Sabati, but no shortage of effort from the striker. Now a nice little turn there from Oshilo, who's coming more and more into it, and carried away at the back by the Tux defence. But not far, though. Again, back to Madiba. Starting to become a little more compact in the middle of the park between these two sides, looking to settle into some sort of pattern. Slight mistake from the Rakodue, but supported back. Yes, from Kuketsubahula. There's no doubt that TUT are the better side at the moment, and the creativity for me is wonderful up until the final third. And in that final delivering pass, it seems to lack the clinical touch to open the scoring.
It's all about decision making, how you take the ball and how you receive the ball when they give you a good pass as an opponent.
Coach Simpiwe Tlutlu directing traffic from the touchline. There has been quite a lot of traffic coming from TUT to that Tux defense. Now the players forward again. Another opportunity that goes wide of the target. It's another corner kick. That's 4-0 as far as corners are concerned for the Tshwane University of Technology. Kailana once again getting involved off that left-hand side.
If you were to see her, she just tried it and tried to take the shot and it deflected. Unfortunately, it went outside. It was definitely going straight to the keeper. It was just going to test Andreas Suraj.
Butler doing a good job to get in the way. So for the fourth time in the match, Maputi Manamela. It's a little bit closer to that far post. The ball hasn't gone out of play just yet, though. Dropped into the middle, knocked away by Alexandra Michael. Tanya Oliveira. Michael once again. Oliveira's got a little bit of work to do. The keeper's come off her line by a country mile here, and is going to have to make the contact. It does. Tshwane thought she was a bit ambitious and wasn't going to get there, but she did.
That was a good decision as a keeper. You've made the decision that you're coming out as a keeper. You definitely need to go all the way out and try and win the ball by all means. And then that's what she did.
And mistake of Billy, no bright yellow colours today. Pressure on the Tshwane's done well. The rare opportunities that she's had to make interventions. This is Manamela one more time. Playing from deep this time. Little nice little left footer. Kailana suddenly got a little bit of space because the fullback is out of position there. Mahoa. Kailana. Well, can she create the opportunity herself? Well, she pulls it back to Sabati. Sabati can't orchestrate the opportunity. Makura trying to make the clearance. Manamela in with a chance. Now Matiba. Goes the aerial route, and that's behind for the goal kick. And once again, TUT getting that ball beautifully into that attacking position, not able to take the chance though.
Look, Kailana had done a very good job. She defeated the centre-back, and then she laid it for Rachel Sibati. Unfortunately, the decision-making was too late. She could have taken a shot, maybe hit it with her laces direct to the keeper, because she did make the first shot at the first time.
Well, she shows up good skill. There's a free kick to the Tshwane University of Technology. Now, wonder what we can see from a set-piece opportunity.
Look, Kailana is trying to get there on time, but it seems like her positioning sometimes is good, and definitely she's going to find something once she keeps on running like that.
Kwaba with a foul on Mashilo. So let's have a look at this set-piece opportunity. Sumaraj looking to position herself well. Out of the ball, comes off the post and back into play. Still another opportunity for Kailana. Eventually, clearance comes from the UP Ducks defenders and continue to live dangerously. Mashilwana, no problems as far as throw-ins are concerned for TUT. Just to remind you that the women's competition, two groups of four teams each. One match today, two tomorrow, semi-finals on Saturday, final on Thursday next week at the Tshwane University of Technology. Saturday it will be the log leaders in Group A against the runners-up in Group B and the other way around as well.
Here's Mashilwana just taking that curler to the first pole, and unfortunately just hit the pole and the keeper was already late. It could have hit the back of the net. It was just a matter of an inch.
Look at these attempts here. 12-1. Unbelievable so far from TUT. Well, 8 out of 12 is not too shabby. That's a 66.67%. conversion rate as far as shots taken to those on target. No goals though out of those, which will be the disappointing factor for the Tshwane University of Technology. Getting away by Norris, and the resulting shot goes past the upright. The final 5 minutes of the first half, 35 minutes for each half today. That shot taken by Mashilwani. One can understand that he's a little bit concerned to Bokamokai. They had the firepower to have scored a bucket full of goals already. You can see by the statistics, 12 shots, 8 on target, everyone was wide, so 13-8. But still, Norris away from in front of Rachel Sabati.
It's all about the decision making in the final third.
You're absolutely right. So, forward by Kailana, this is a drop back by Alexandra Michael. Michael doing some good work. It's a nice bit of skill from her. And she gets past Rakuduve. The flick inside from Shannon Morgan wasn't of the greatest qualities. And back it comes here from TUT with Mashilwani. Mashilwani. It's a nice little ball through to Mashilo. Now Mashilo wide to Kailana. Kailana with a good bit of pace about her. She runs out of gas just behind the challenge of Lebohang Butler. Relying quite a lot on her from the left-hand side. Maybe it's becoming predictable.
Look, her pace, they're definitely going to make good use of her pace. If she's got room to run, she's definitely going to run them down and maybe whip in those good crosses. Harry knows.
The University of Pretoria Tucks only have 3 minutes in stoppage time to survive all the onslaughts from TUT playing with the stiffish breeze. Tucks playing into it. And then the change of fortune potentially in only the second half, where we might see just balls being banged in the aerial route from Tucks up the field of play. And who knows, in the bounce of the ball, how things could change.
He's fuming because he's got those chances in the final step, but the players are just not delivering.
It'll be interesting half-time chat in the dressing room. Each half might only be 35 minutes, but there's still a 15-minute half-time here. This is Kwaba for the University of Pretoria Tucks. Looking for the delivery, cut out by Rabada Lepele. Now a chance for Mashilo. Just for the moment, there was a bit of defensive work coming from TUT, but now Mashilo. Nice run from Mashilo. Well cut out there by Vuyela Makura. Midfielder for TUT. Referee ducks out of the way, Linduwe Twalip as well. Don't forget, game of football, the referee's part of the field of play. So if the referee does take a pass, then wherever the ball lands, the plays have to continue from that. Even if it's a handball from the referee, it doesn't matter. How far up the field of play here Papela Lepele is playing. She's a central defender and she's 10 yards inside the half of the University of Pretoria Tucks, leaving only Koketo Mahlangu back behind the halfway line. He has Tlailana one more time. Tlailana's done so well today. Tlailana. Rado by Mabatle, picked up by Rakodue. Mashilwani. Mashilo will go wide here to Mopana. This is a good build-up again from the Tshwane University of Technology. Nice skill from the fullback as well. Brings Rakodue into play. Got so much space available. Now there's a great chance. Once again, the fullback pick up on Mabatla. The centre-back gets in the way. And this one will eventually get into the back of the net. Keeper of her line, ball over the top. Finally, TUT draw first blood. Minute before half-time. It looks as if it's Sipati might have grabbed the opening goal of the match.
Now Tucks wanted to clear the ball there. Unfortunately, it just landed on Rachel Sipati, and she had a very clear look at the keeper, and then she took that curler direct above the keeper. She was off the line, and it bit the keeper.
Well, congratulations offered by her midfield, but finally TUT have been able to open their account now. Well, the floodgates open here before halftime, which is just a matter of seconds away. Ball into the penalty area, and a no call from the goalkeeper. Mbatle trying to make the clearance, and there's a foul from the TUT players. There is the captain of the Tshwane University, the Tuck side, I beg your pardon, that is Lebogang Mbatle, who made that clearance a moment ago. So into stoppage time in Potchefstroom. We are at the Fani de Tooi Sports Complex. 1 minute added on by referee Linduwe Twala. And possession statistics must be well in favour of the University of Pretoria Tucks. Another chance though for Mashilwani. Keeps it in play. I think that's going to be a late corner kick, is it? Well, has he given a penalty? It might have even been a handball. No, it's a handball just outside the penalty area. So a free kick to Tshwane University of Technology. Back in defense there is Zinise Norris. So free kick time. Keeper will punch. Lands to Mashilwani. And the ball bobbling around in that area. The referee spotting a bit of a push there from TUT. And Tucks will have an opportunity to clear their lines. The 1 minute of time added on by referee. Twala has been completed already.
It was a good cross. It's just that the Tucks center backs were right there, and Rachel Sipati couldn't hit the ball and direct it to the goal post, which is good defending for Tucks because they were able to defend that.
20 minutes into the second minute of time added on, and still no halftime whistle from Twala. Must have been a foul throw there, or a little push from one of the TUT players. Free kick to the University of Pretoria Tucks. Waiting for a ball to be thrown onto the park here from the side of the pitch. That's the lass who scored the goal a moment ago, Sipati. It was a nice opportunity she took. Spotted the keeper off her line. Checked it to perfection over the goalkeeper. Well done to her as well. fought by Makura for the University of Pretoria. Tucks all the way back to the keeper, Petronella Chilwani. Koketa Mahlangu turns the ball to Mahlangu. 2 minutes of time has been played. Now Manamela. I'm surprised that Manamela is playing this far back because he's been very adventurous so far in this encounter. Mpana can't find a way through past Kutso Mojadipe. It's a nice little ball as well from Mashilo. Mashilwani looking adventurous. Well, 2.5 minutes into first half stoppage time. Eventually, the halftime whistle comes from Lindu Witwala. And while TUT really struggled to get themselves onto the score sheet, eventually the goal did come. Pulled up in the middle of the park. There was a shot that was parried away by the Tux defence. And there was Zabati at the right place at the right time to just chip it over the top of Andreas Sumaraj for the only goal of the first half. TUT with the most of the opportunities, most of the possession as well, certainly the best of the chances, playing from the left and the right hand side, down the middle as well. But Sabati's goal separates TUT from UP Tux. It's halftime in Potchefstroom.
Well, halfway into this tie between TUT and the University of Pretoria, it is the defending champions that lead by a goal to nil, and it took them a while to get that goal, but right before the stroke of half-time, they managed to get that opening goal, and it's really something that they really deserved, having created at least 13 shots at goal in that opening half, 9 of them of on target, and while it seemed as if they wouldn't get that goal, they made sure that just before the end of the first half, they managed to get ahead, and that's something they'll be looking to build on coming into the second half. As far as Tux are concerned, they've got plenty of work to do if they are to avoid defeat in this particular match. We'll take a short break. When we come back, it's the highlights of the opening 55 minutes.
Welcome you back to the Northwest University Bukker in Potchefstroom. We're at the Fani du Toit Sports Complex where varsity sports football for ladies gets underway. And TUT in the opening match in the Tshwane Derby. Lead by 1-0 courtesy of this lass, Rachel Sabati. So many attacks. 11 shots on target in the first half. One in the back of the net with the wind blowing behind them. And there's a stiffish breeze that's going to be blowing behind Tux in the second half of this encounter. We wait to see whether there's going to be any change in their fortunes, though, as there's a big discussion with Alexandra Michael and Temakwanati Tuna, who was playing down the left-hand side during the course of the first half. Wait to see if there's any substitutions coming into the match. That's Tony Oliveira, who was fighting almost a lone cause up front into the wind here in Potchefstroom. We'll wait to see whether they can adapt their game plan and maybe knock those long balls up and test the defense of Mapana, Mahlangu, Lepele and Tlailana. We'll see lots of adventure from the fullbacks from TUT during the first half. Now with the wind going into them, do we see a change and do the fullbacks then hang back to anticipate long balls being played down the flanks and through the middle by the University of Pretoria Tux? All will be revealed. This is where the coaches come into play. Ntebogo Mokae and Simpiwe Ludlu both have some experience in the game of football. There's no doubt about that. Referee Lindu Witwala is our official out in the middle, ready to get the match underway for the second half. It's TUT will have the centre pass, and they'll play from right to left in the second period. Well, a bit of a late delay here because it's going to be a substitution for the University of Pretoria Tux, who are going to bring on McClody Tillering, and off goes the right-sided fullback Matlakala Makoa. So that's an interesting change. Someone Chabaleng is on. Makoa's off. We wait to see where Tobeling's going to play. She was given to us as a defender, so she'll probably slot into that right back position. Underway for the second half then. It's Tux trail TUT in the Tshwane Derby by 1-0. Tied it up there by Rabalo Lepele. I can tell you that Tobeling has dropped over onto the right-hand side of defense. And her first task is to try and cope with Lailana. That's going to be an interesting one. Fresh pair of legs against a player who was absolutely lighting it up in the first half.
It's a very good substitution. The strength between Chabeling and Kailane is almost similar. So it's definitely going to be tough maybe for Kailane to bypass and Chabeling if we were to look at the strength. And obviously Kailane is always running them down. And Chabeling will probably block it in time.
So an interesting one. There's lots to look forward to as far as the second half of this encounter is concerned. Don't forget that each half is just 35 minutes long. An opportunity almost immediately here for Michael, all the way by the goal scorer, Rachel Sabati. Now, no offside flag against Matiba. Can Matiba make it 2-0? She certainly can. Number of opportunities in the first half that she wasn't able to accomplish. That's the goal that TT would have wanted early on, playing against the wind. Zmiraj beaten for the second time in the match. And he's Shani University of Technology doubling their goal score. It was Sabati in the first half, Matiba in the second.
It was a very good ball from Rachel Sabati. She just picked Matiba, and Matiba had that first chance. She's just delayed the ball a little bit, and then she looked at the keeper, and then she picked the spot, which is a beautiful goal, good decision making, and she was composed enough to just put the ball at the back of the net.
Well, the celebrations are from TUT. The coach doesn't quite crack a smile just yet. Maybe he's just acting coolio. But it is the Tshwane University of Technology who score either side of halftime, a lead by 2-0. That's a real setback for UP Tuck, who would have come out for the second half and maybe thought about some of the tactics that we were discussing upstairs here, myself and my expert analyst for the afternoon, former goalkeeper for TUT in the men's competition, Moganinda. So 2-0 TUT. There's the social media platforms then. Supersport TV, hashtag SS Football, there's Facebook, there's Twitter, and all manner of different social media platforms that you can get involved in. Well, just battling to get the ball back into play here suddenly are the University of Pretoria. Tucks are perhaps a little bit shell-shocked as well, because that ball came almost against the run of play as far as TUT were concerned. It was a nice breakaway from Matiba, and for once she kept her head. This is Makura who clears for the University of Pretoria Tucks. The Taha Matiba is an interesting player, because we've seen a bit of that fancy footwork that we see sometimes in the PSL on players that we've mentioned already. And so she's got a bit of skill about her. Finally, she's managed to convert some of that skill into something tangible on the score sheet. Preparing your picture is Zina De Norris, central defender alongside of Mabatle, the captain of the University of Pretoria Tucks. Rakutuwe. A little flick across the area here, and another opportunity for TUT. Just a little snatch at it, and it goes over the top.
Okay, it was a good trap by Litahu Madiba, and unfortunately Buntle Mashilo was nowhere near. She was right there next to her. She just did not read that the ball was being laid for her. She could have taken a very good shot and lacing it up towards the keeper.
Could be a busy second half for Andrea Sumaraj, because TUT are playing a very, very high line indeed, and putting a lot of pressure on the central defenders in Mapatle and Norris. Haven't seen quite the challenge between Kailana and the substitute right side at fullback doubling just yet.
Look, it looks like TUT is really making it, taking it up, high up to tax. They're not resting in their own half now. They're marking the opponents in their half, which is good for them. You can see the fouls are in the opponent's half. That is good for TUT, if I were to say.
Yeah, I think it's a deliberate ploy from Coach Mokai, and it's a good ploy as well. Now, Tux looking to spread the ball wide onto the right-hand side, where Michael has been playing for most of the match, except for one little foray onto the left-hand side a bit earlier on. Pressure for the clearance on Mahlangu. That should be a throw into the Victoria side on the eastern side of the capital city. Might have even been a handball from Dudizile Kwaba. Nothing called from the officials, though, and the throw-in does go to the Tshwane University of Technology. So how did the University of Pretoria Tucks come back from that early setback? Because only trailing by 1-0, I think they might have fancied themselves to get something out of this encounter. They've got even more work to do now, as we have a look at Alexandra Michael. right winger for the University of Pretoria Tux side. Now, here's an opportunity for Letaka Madiba again. She just scored a couple of minutes ago. It's a lovely ball into the middle. Is it another chance? It certainly is. It's Mashilo who adds weight to the scoring. And the first 5 minutes of the second half have certainly been a massive, massive benefit to TUT, because not only are they creating like they did in the first half, but they're converting as well.
It's very evident enough, Kevin, if you were to see how TUT are actually attacking University of Pretoria right now. They're all finding themselves in the box as the opponents. If you look at Madiba, she just pushed the ball a little bit and then laid it over. And then you can see Mashilo was there just to trap the ball and have enough time to obviously direct into the back of the net, and the keeper had nothing to do there.
TUT really driving home the halftime advantage of 1-0. They've scored 2 goals inside of 6 minutes. And Madiba and Mashilo adding to the goal of Sibaji. TUT leading 3-0. Just 6 minutes into the second half of this opening match. It's Group B in Varsity Sports Women's Football. Just to remind you that there's 2 matches for each of the teams tomorrow in both Group A and Group B. The semi-finals on the Saturday. The final on Wednesday, the 22nd in the afternoon, before the grand finale of the men's final between TUT and the University of Johannesburg. And Mr. Moguninda, how... are you itching to perhaps even get on the field on Thursday? Not that you can, but yeah, it must be a great opportunity having missed out in 2013.
Okay, I'm happy that TUT finally reaches the finals, and I just pray and hope that they definitely seal it and just let the trophy remain at home. They've fought enough. They've had a good fair run in this tournament, and this is their chance to just keep the trophy in the city of Tshwane.
They have had a great opportunity, yes. 3 out of the 4 years have been won by the Pretoria side, the University of Pretoria Tux on the eastern side in the men's competition we're talking about, and once by the University of Western Cape last year, who beat TUT in the final. But TUT once again getting themselves into that prime position, looking for an opportunity to clinch the championship this time around in the fourth season of Varsity Sports Football. It's a great initiative, is Varsity Sports. So many different sports that you can choose from, but glad that you're with us in the football fraternity this afternoon on your World of Champions. Offside here against Madiba this time.
Seems like TUT have changed their style of play. They're taking the ball to the far out of the field, and it's working for them. Madiba was able to just put in that hard and low cross, and it's working for them. So definitely coach Tebogo Mokae had told him something in the change room to change their style of play, and the way they attack, and the final third is reached, and it's a good one for them.
Yeah, there just doesn't seem to be too much coming back from the University of Pretoria Tux at the moment. Once again, Alexandra Michael coming back to even help defensively. But now there's left a bit of a gap, because that pass was aimed exactly to where Michael should have been. So easy pickings for Pabalo Lepele, even decides to take on Tanya Oliveira. Very meager pickings, and there's been such a slim amount of opportunities that have come the way of Morgan and Oliveira. So a little flick away by Rakutuwe. Back in it comes from Tux's number 13, who is in Chabeleng, who came on as a substitute. Now it's Kwaba. Kwaba has been poached by Rakutuwe. Easy as you like here for Bontle Mashilo, who's the latest of the 3 goal scorers. And they just seem to be in quite relaxed mode at the moment, our TUT. It's almost as if, well, we've got this far, we're leading by 3-0, and we've got 2 tough games tomorrow. We're just going to chill a little bit here. But that might come back to haunt them, because he has a chance for a goal to be pulled back, and it is. UP Tux are pushed forward in their draft run. Well, the keeper, Tilwani, caught up a line, and this might be the cause of a little bit of an upstart from the University of Pretoria Tux. Butley, he's a centre-back.
That's all you need to do when you're a player. Just press them down. Unfortunately, the keeper and obviously Buntle, they couldn't communicate on time. And if you can see that, the captain of Tux went on and put pressure on them. And it was just a good thing for her. And then she got the goal, which is beautiful then.
Wonderful adventure from her.
It's a matter of a decision making by the keeper. The communication was late, and there it is. You can see that the captain of University of Pretoria just got in between of them, and then she won the ball and put it in the back of the net. Lack of communication from the keeper.
Yeah, it's terrific stuff though from the captain of the University of Pretoria, Tux, Lebogang Mabatle. And they've had so little in the way of opportunity, but they managed to grab a goal back here. So 45 minutes into the match, Tux grab a goal. Is it a consolation match or is it the fire that's going to be ignited? And the side that plays on the eastern side of the capital city, still TUT leading by 3-1. Here's Michael looking for Oliveira, and Michael a little chip down the touchline. Michael putting pressure on Lepele. Safety first from TUT, and suddenly Tux look a different side. Just to confirm for you then that it is Salome Kekana who's come on for Maputi Manimela. Manimela was a lazo to putting a lot of crosses into the penalty area from TUT during the first half. Seems to run out of gas maybe. Salome Kekana has been introduced by coach Tebogo Mokae. Chance here for Oliveira. Knocks it into the middle of the park, no man's land, and a big challenge there between Mabatle and Rakuvudi, the captains of the two sides. Some wide play now by Mashilo, and just goes wide of the substitute. Salome Kekana seems to have dropped just onto the right-hand side to start with. In fact, that is Madibo who's moved over to the right-hand side because Kekana seems to be in a much more central striker role. There's a player down here from the University of Pretoria Tux, hence Ndiwe Twala's little sprint across the pitch. There's the goal scorer and captain for the University of Pretoria Tux, Lebogang Mabakle. She had the ball in the back of the net just a few moments ago, and she really does look as if she's in some distress.
It was just a matter of that she took the shot, and then Lebogang Rakuduwe, she had her foot also on the ball, and then they contacted and she was just injured. Unfortunately, it was just that she was late and Lebogang had already committed with her foot, and then that's why they knock on her ankle.
The player that is coming off here is Shannon Morgan. She'll make way for Andri Krichel, who's a natural right winger. She seems to have dropped onto the right hand side, so I wonder where Alexandra Michael will then pop up. Michael looks as if she's drifting across to the left hand side, which is going to be interesting. She had a brief moment on the left hand side in the first half, did Alexandra Michael. It looks as if it's going to be much more of a permanent position unless she drops into the pocket. Just hanging around in that defensive midfield position at the moment is Alexandria Michael. This is Mashilo for the Tshwane University of Technology. So a little bit of a change in formation here for Simpiwe Dudu. Rakuduwe. It's gone very quiet around the watch area just at the moment. Yeah, everything just seemed to come to a sudden stop. But, I think it's going to be a great evening tonight because looking out of our commentary box window across the trees, I can see it almost looks like a full moon. So I think later on it's going to be a beautiful, beautiful spectacle here. Clear skies, nearly full moon, and another injury in the middle of the park for the Tshwane University of Technology this time. I think Lulu will be happy that her side's got himself onto the score sheet. Won't be happy with the injury to her captain, Mabatle. There's still work to be done here. In the meantime, the player that's injured looks like Mashilo. So both goal scorers, or scorers from both sides injured, both wearing the number 12 jersey. Mabatle just a few moments ago. Now, Bontle Mashilo, who scored 6 minutes into the second half, goes off for some medical treatment. Do have strikers on the bench. We've already seen Salome Kekana come on. There's Salome Dikhale, who's a striker as well, that can come on for the Tshwane University of Technology if required, unless they want to bring on defenders, and then they have a right back in Mabatu Dire and Mapule Nklapo. There's also Catherine Makhoboka, who's a central defense, but let's change that for a moment because here comes Salome Kekana. Well, that was a challenge just on the edge of the penalty area from Makhlodi Nchabeleng. Referee's gone to the pocket. It's no great surprise, I don't think. If that had been in the penalty area, there would have been a spot kick. The coach looks concerned about his player. Nice break, though.
It sure is a booking. It was just, she pushed the ball quite very well, and the player was very late, and then she decided to tackle it on the right-hand side, and the ball was on her left-hand side, so she definitely has to get Nchabeleng Mahlodi that yellow card that she just got now.
Yeah, there's no doubt about that. The challenge was very, very late indeed, and just clipped the ankle of the TUT substitute. Well, the free kicks are going to be taken into the wind, but that's the amount of fouls in the match so far. Just 13 of them in nearly 50 minutes of play. Only the one yellow card as well. The first yellow card going to Nchabeleng, the substitute. Free kick's gone wide of the target from Khomotso Mashilwane. And the pressure's been relieved just for the moment from a tax perspective.
I think to show a little bit room there behind the hole, it was just unfortunate. Unlucky for it went outside the net, and the keeper was just far from the wall, actually.
Yeah, well, that was a lot closer than I thought it was initially. Ball picked up here by Mabatle, who seems to recover it from her injury. Tucked back by Koketso Klailana, who's been very quiet in the second half so far. We haven't seen those little darting runs, and maybe she's intimidated by Ntabeleng, or maybe the work's been done. And we spoke about with the wind blowing into their faces, if the fullbacks will be a little bit more cautious. It's proven to be the case.
Look, the work's been done. They definitely need to remain in their halves, otherwise UP will utilize the opportunity. The wind is favoring them. They can definitely go hard on TUT, and should they find them not there, they're definitely going to want to seal the back of the net and get a goal.
Madiba with a foul that time, and a free kick for the University of Pretoria Tucks. I want to get that ball down the field of play as quickly as possible. Just to remind you, coming up at 1830 hours Central African time, the second match, the first one in Group B, University of the Western Cape against Northwest University. Bucca, the home side, getting an advantage to play there as well. Don't forget, Mashilo picked up a bit of a knocker a few moments ago, and her place is going to be taken by Mapule Nhlapo, who's a defender. So maybe this is the time for Teboho Mokai to go a bit defensive, because he's taken off a striker, sent on a defensive player. Now, is that a good idea, or is it too early?
It's not really early. They just need to defend that two goals that they've scored already.
Oliveira looking to get between the TUT defenders, and first time we've really seen her latching onto a ball in that sort of dangerous area. Don't forget, only 70 minutes. That's 7-0 minutes played here. 35 minutes aside. Are we 18 minutes away from second half stoppage time? Still plenty of time if Tucks can continue to build. And Mabatla, the captain who scored a goal moments ago, is looking very adventurous here from her centre back position. But she hasn't been able to keep the ball in play the way she wanted. Yeah, she's quite an adventurous player. Central defender now almost converted into a striking role here by the coach. On the defensive is Mapule Nhlapo, who's just come on as a sub. Looks as if she slotted into a left-back position in the place of Klailana. So where does Klailana end up? As an attacking midfielder, because that's probably more where she'd like to play. It's going to be a corner for UP Tucks, the first of the game. In the meantime, it's going to be a substitution as well, and it's going to be Dudizile Kwaba, who is going to make way for Tobejani. Amikar Tobejani, who is a striker, so midfield player coming off and a striker going on. They started with two holding midfielders, did UP Tucks today, so they've taken one of those off, and Amikar Tobejani will come on to add some weight up front. Corner's been taken. The ball just goes wide of the target. Is it successive corners? Referee says yes. So back-to-back corners here for Tucks. So this is a good bit of pressure being exerted by the UP Tucks side right now. It will again be Alexandra Michael who will take it and look for her captain, no doubt, Lebohang Mabatle. Keeper comes out. Doesn't make much of a contact. Ball found the back of the net. And Tucks are within one of drawing level with TUT. Ball's been slotted in there. I'll just confirm the goal scorer for you. But it looks as if it could be the fullback there. No, in fact, it's the midfielder, Demokonati Luna, plays on the left-hand side.
It all goes to Paul watching. The cross was put in quite nice towards the keeper, and the keeper just punched it, and the player found it there with no hesitation. She just hit it towards the net, and the keeper was kept napping. She couldn't find the ball.
For me, what was quite impressive there was the presence of Tobejani in front of the goalkeeper, Petronella Chilwani, because she got in the way of Chilwani. Chilwani really couldn't get the punch away that she wanted to, and Lina was in the right place at the right time. Packs the ball in the back of the net. And it's Tucks who creep to within one of TUT. Now, in 2014 in the final, there were five goals between these two sides, and all five of them went to TUT. There's five again today. It's a little closer.
It is getting a little bit closer. Should TUT be flat-footed like that, Tucks is definitely going to walk away with a draw and maybe defend it and then work better on their next game tomorrow.
Yeah, it is all about going through all three matches, and as we spoke about a bit earlier on, it's tough. I don't know if you've ever been in a competition where you've played two full matches on the same day. Here's Madiba again, and there's an opportunity on the wide side for Madiba. Oh, the keeper makes a terrible hash of things. No hands been used there, no feet as well. And that's terrible. Matiba grabs a brace and the two-goal cushion is restored. So really a bit of a debacle in defence for the University of Pretoria. Tuxi knows it's a mirage. Should have done better, but Matiba grabs a brace in the match. 8 minutes before half-time.
Look, it was a very beautiful ball from Tloale, and then Matiba just decided to take the ball and then just put it behind the net. And the keeper was standing right there. She couldn't do much. She just wanted to kick the ball away. Unfortunately, the ball was strong enough to go past it.
Yeah, not the greatest of techniques been used by Andrea Sumaraj. But Tuxa just crept to within one goal of TUT. A moment to go with a goal from Thuna. But the brace from Matiba makes it 4-2 in favour of TUT. A six-goal thriller. Still, there's 14 minutes remaining in stoppage time, so we could have more goals here in Potchefstroom. And really not a bad match to start the women's competition in varsity football. That's a foul throw this time from the Tshwane University of Technology. Guilty parties, the substitute, Mapule and Klapo. Seen a number of those today. None from Tux in the second half, though, as Alexandra Michael tries to swap the ball through to Oliveira. Oliveira chasing down Rakudue. Rakudue has done well. Spreads it across to Alansi Mopana. Now Mopana up to Madiba, who's on a hat-trick. Closed down very swiftly at the back by Ntabeleng. In fact, it's not Ntabeleng, it's Mojadibe. Sebati. Rakudue. Now look where Klailana suddenly finds herself. She's playing as an attacking midfielder, comes striker just behind the substitute, Salome Gekana. Little scramble at the back here for the UP Tux defense, but they don't need to worry because the offside flag has gone up as well from Taumang Maneo, the assistant referee on the far side. Krichel trying to apply a little bit of pressure to Mapule and Klapo. Klapo's done well here to get past the Tux substitute. Finds Rakudue. Taken away by Alexandra Michael. If there is a player that's worked her socks off today, it is Alexandra Michael for UP Tux. But an opportunity once again. Offside flag stays down. TUT looking for a chance with Kekana. And Sumaraz does go to ground this time.
That's lack of decision making from the player. She had all the room to just control the ball and push it a little bit forward and then pick a spot, maybe push it again if it was too far for her, and then maybe try and find the back of the net, take a shot at the keeper or pick a spot.
Good play again from Kekana, finds Klailana. Klailana works away easily past Krichel. Rakudue, oh, lovely skill from her too. Rakudue looking for some space. Still Rakudue. Chance for Mashilwane. They're on the scramble again. This is the sort of play we saw from TUT during the first half, for much of the first half, and they're scrambling defense for UP Tux. And suddenly with that fourth goal, TUT, after Tux had closed to within just the one goal a few minutes ago, TUT have opened their gap once again, and now suddenly they're starting to play that sort of pressure football that we saw very little of in the second half so far. But they will apply the pressure. Looking for some supply coming from the flank on that occasion. That didn't make any progress. Yeah, they come again, and lovely play here from Mashilwani. Away by Makura for Tux. Tux under a lot of pressure right now. This is Tobajani. And some foul play from Rakudue. He seems very, very surprised that the referee gave the free kick the other way.
It must be the adrenaline, because right here she just pulled the player and tried to block it, and then she claims that she won the ball fairly, so it was not fairly. Unfortunate, she couldn't win that one.
So a little bit of obstruction there on the latest of the substitute, the third substitute, Amolkar Tobajani. Had a role in the third goal that was scored, a big upon the second goal that was scored by Mina. And here we go, breakaway time again on a hat-trick here. Is Matiba again, the legs coming to operation, then eventually she goes to ground again. Sumaraj, she had to be brave for the second time of asking, but Matiba missing out on a hat-trick right there. But who knows whether it makes any difference at, in the final reckoning. One has to wait and see, because we're 10 minutes away from second half stoppage time. Michael to Oliveira here. Krichel waiting on the left-hand side. The triangle doesn't quite work out for UP Tux, as Rabelo Lapele gets herself involved in that little attempted attack from the Pretoria East side. It's tough out there in the middle of the park, and she's done a lot of playmaking today. Rachel Sibati scored the opening goal in the 35th minute.
There you can see Rachel Sibati had already won the ball. Unfortunately, the player from Tux just had to put her foot in there and block her, and then that's when Rachel Sibati took the dive.
Ball here to Mapule and Klapo. Unfortunately for her, the offside flag is up. And while UP Tux have only scored two to the four of the Tshwane University of Technology, I still think that UP Tux could have shipped a whole bunch more goals, and there has been a fair amount of discipline in their defending. Not enough to have prevented the four goals being scored by the two-time champions, but sure you know what I mean. This is Nklapo. Switch play to Sibati. Now over the top, and an opportunity once again for TUT. Offside flag is up this time against Salome Kekana.
It's quite an interesting one, Kevin. If you were to look at UP Tux, the way they've started, they started with the tall players playing at the centre-back, and now they move them into the midfield in the middle of the park, and then now there's a huge gap at the back because the short players that are there, and TUT is just looping the balls behind them and then taking those runs, and obviously Tux is trying to attack with the tall players.
It's interesting to see that Kwaba has dropped back into the centre of defence, and you've got Mapatle masquerading as a striker, and I suppose desperate times call for desperate measures. This is exactly what Tux are doing, and one could argue that they are showing some versatility perhaps as Krichel. It's a nice bit of composed play at the back by the Tshwane University of Technology, as Klailana, not as influential in the second half as she was in the first, and that's going to be a little overcooked towards Andreas Sumaraj. Krichel knocks it forward, tapped away by Rabalo Lepele. Composure by Koketo Mahlangu. TUT won't want to give anything away in the final 7 minutes and stoppage time of this encounter. Knocked away by Moja Dube for the University of Pretoria. Tux picked up by Tobajani. She can't hold on for too long. Now there's an opportunity here for Apule Nklapo. It's a strong challenge from Ntabeleng, but still, TUT have numbers forward here. A little ball forward by Mashilwani. Now wide to Matiba. Straight off the chest of the Sumaraj. She didn't know too much about that, but it didn't matter. She got her whole body behind the ball. I suppose that's the most important thing.
She just couldn't handle it. It was a very strong ball. She had the body behind, and then it was just a good save for her. It was just she couldn't handle it. Look at Matiba. She took the shot, and then Samaraj, she was just late with closing it in into her chest, and then it hit the chest, and then it fell to the side. But it's good. It is behind. Body behind the ball is what matters.
There'll be no hat-trick for Lerato or Letago or Matiba today, because the place has been taken by Salome Dikgale. So a striker for a striker. With 6 minutes of stoppage time remaining for the Tshwane University of Technology, it seems unlikely that Tux could find their way back onto a level position now that they're trailed by two goals. But stranger things have happened in the game of football. Taka Matiba's had a good match today with the brace that she scored. Salome Dikgale will come on for the final part of this match as the final change in the game as well. Bude. Should be easy pickings for Sumaraj. There have been some moments, I think, for University of Pretoria Tux today, but yeah, there's clearly a difference between the two sides, isn't there?
There is definitely a difference, and if you look at the University of Pretoria team, there is character is there. It's just that it's a matter of them trying to find that style of play and understanding each other in the field. Then something could come out from them, because they are a good team. They are attacking TUT. Now that the second half they changed the style of play, it's working for them.
Nice little ball through the middle again by Mbatle. It just eludes Alexandra Michael. Picked up again by Mapule and Klapo. Klapo with a little triangle from Mashilwani. There go opportunities here. Offside flag stays down with Kekana. Lost the ball under her feet for a moment, being tracked by the former holding midfielder, now centre-back, Makura. Makura's done brilliantly. 5 minutes of stoppage time in Potchefstroom, separating TUT from opening their accounts.
Look, it's a very good, skillful, but why are you going back? Go to the opposition's goal post instead of you going back. Now you lose the ball, and this is what happens now.
Michael with some switch play. Eventually cleared away by Lanti Mopana. So through the middle again comes Kekana. Makura for company. Makara. Look upon Makura trying to do what Sabati did on the stroke of half time. Goes wide. The middle here, Rachel Sabati. She'll be happy with her game today, tidied up by Alexandra Michael, who's really been the standout for Tucks today. I don't think anyone can argue about that, along with the captain Lebogang Mahatle, who scored one of the goals. Mahatle, I beg your pardon. The pressure being exerted in the final minutes for TUG, and this is exactly where they want to play their football. I want to drop inside of their own half, see out the rest of the match. Even if they don't score from a sort of position, Mo, the job's been done. 3 minutes of stoppage time remaining. They lead by 4-2. If they continue to play where they're playing now, that's it.
Look, that's the only thing that matters. It's the last minute of the game. Keep the play the game high. Remain in the opposition's half. Press them high. Remain in them, because if you allow them to come to your yard, they're definitely going to want to get the back of the net. So definitely deny them room to play in your own yard.
Play here to Chabeleng. Came on as a second half substitute. Good pressure from the top of the field from Kekana. That's doing it the right way, because as soon as the ball's turned around, everybody becomes a defender. Kekana showing exactly there the coaching from Tebogo Mokai, and some good concentration and focus coming through from the substitute player. Hard work being done by Andre Krichel, but the ball still comes out to Mapule and the Klapo. Now Kekana once again relishing in the space she's been given. First time ball into the penalty area. Whipped away by Zinedine Morris. Only as far as Rakadue. I thought she was going to try those adventurous shots from there. Klailane, Rakadue, Klailane, Kekana! Off the post and behind for a kick.
Now that's the decision that she wished she could have, and she shouldn't have made, because she could have just pushed the ball a little bit and maybe pulled in a harder load towards to the last pole. She had a teammate right there. She could have done something. If you look at Rakudi, she's playing nice 1-2, and then there she is. She comes in with the pole and then she takes a shot. Unfortunately, did not hit the back of the net. Unless it's sometimes it's all about the decision making. Your final decision matters. So she took the decision to take the shot. It hit the goal post.
They'll still get a corner out of it, because the referee's a judge that came off the hands of Sumaraj. So Kekana will slide that in. Easy pickings, sort of, for Sumaraj. Now, it's been a bit of a tough afternoon for the University of Pretoria Ducks. Oliveira finds Tobajani. Will stab wide here into Krichel. Krichel with an opportunity. Good cover provided by Mahlandu. No real problems for Chulwane. We enter the final minutes of regulation time at the Northwest University Potchefstroom. We are at the Fani du Toit Sports Complex, and the opening match of the women's varsity sports football competition is a Tuani derby. TUT doing what they've done probably more often than not, certainly by 5-0 in 2014 in the final of the competition, when they met their city rivals, winning 5-0. Today we've had 6, 4 of those to Tucks as well. Krichel on the turn. Very cool, calm and collected by Rakutue. This is Makura. Poached away by Mashilwani. Some strong challenges coming in suddenly.
Tucks is definitely closing them down high up there, because they just want to get the back of the net as well. So that's why you see Tucks players, about 8 of them right there. It's unfortunate that this player was just tackled so late, but she just jumped. The ref just gave him the ball. She jumped, unfortunately.
Sabachi opened the scoring just before half time for TUT. They're led by a goal to nil at half time, so plenty of goals in the second half. Ball knocked away from Clay Lana and stabbed wide by Klapo as they continue to create opportunities, TUT. We are going to have 3 minutes of stoppage time added on. Next match for TUT. We'll have a look at the coach, Teboho Mokae. He's against UFS tomorrow.
Now, if you look at this ball, Suraj had lost the ball, but then she decides to be stylish when taking that shot. She could have just taken the ball quite very well. It would have been a goal.
So through the middle here by Krichel. Finds Tobajani with a shot, and Chilwani somehow goes to ground before the ball reaches her. Still makes the save. We're in stoppage time at the moment. Yeah, just both Tux and TUT will play against the University of Cape Town and the University of the Free State tomorrow. Obviously not at the same time. So Tux will play UCT and TUT UFS in the early games, and they'll switch around for the late matches. Opportunity for the substitute here, Salome Dikhale. Free kick just outside the penalty area. Is it a corner? I think the referee's given a corner to the TUT side.
I think Zenisa Morris has done a great job in this game. She's been quite a solid, a very short defender, but she's always, her presence is felt because she closes you down very quick. She doesn't give you room to play.
Yeah, I've got to agree with you. Outswinger from Kekana. Swung away emphatically by Alexandra Michael. And he reaches Rakutue. Rakutue looking adventurous. That's just going to creep over the crossbar. Michael's injured herself in the middle of that. But Rakutue is a decent player, isn't she? Playmaker. Has good vision around both left and right hand sides and to the middle of it. Michael has picked up a knock and she looks to be in a bit of pain. Yeah, she's taken it on the knee. And she's in a bit of stress here. There's Michael. They've used all three of their substitutions. I don't think it would do any harm whatsoever for Michael just to be taken off the field of play, because there's only 1 minute remaining, really. Trying to straighten that leg, which they've been able to successfully accomplish now. Instructions coming from Sipiwe Dudu, former Banyana player. She's looking for the drive. I think it's a bit too little too late as we look at some of the other ladies' players. Don't forget, coming up in a moment's time is UWC against Northwest University Bucca, and the home fans will have plenty to cheer about from about 6:30. Local time when they start coming to play in their first Group B encounter. That'll be televised. Some school kids have been bussed in to add to the atmosphere. It's always good to see. Earlier on, UJ playing against CUT on the B ground here at the Fani Detoy Stadium. Not any scores coming through from that encounter. But this is a Group B encounter. Group A will have a chance with UWC Northwest University in a few moments' time. 3 minutes added on have elapsed, but the referee quite right to let things run on because of that injury to Alexandra Michael. Michael is still receiving medical attention off the field of play, so Tux could end the match down to 10 men. That's a comfortable save from Sumaraj of Khomotso Mwashilwani, who's been very influential today. Over the head of Oliveira. Nicely kept in play as well by Lepele, who's the centre-back. Kekana's offside.
Salome Kekana felt herself that she was alone, but she kept on running. And that's why it resulted into an offside. Sometimes time-wasting tactics are just different. So this could be one of them, because it's only a minute to the end of the game.
Well, the job's been done. It wasn't done at half-time, because TUT only led by a goal to nil. But really, we've had an avalanche of goals, five of them in the second half alone. And credit to Tux, who crept to within one goal, 3-2 with that goal from Kluna. But after that, Deva grabbing another goal to restore that two-goal cushion in favour of the two-time champions. Now, they're looking decent here as a championship side. We wait to see what happens in the remainder of the competition, because TUT, if they continue in this vein, could very well play in the final along with the men's side who play against UJ in the men's competition next Thursday evening. Still no final whistle here between TUT and Tux, and another opportunity for Nhlapo. Goes down by Makura, tries a little bit of trickery, and it doesn't play off for Nhlapo. I think Makura's had a decent game as well for the University of Pretoria Tux. Tswane University of Technology will start the defence of their championship in good style might have been a bit nervy going into halftime, leading only by 1-0, and we certainly saw some nerves coming from coach Ndebogo Mokae with the avalanche of missed opportunities. 11 chances on target, only 1 goal in the first half, and they buried the opportunities in the second and managed to eventually come up with the first 3-pointer in Group B. Some disappointment maybe for UP Tux, but they've had some good play here. Lebogang Mbatle scored one of the goals and Cleaner the other one. We saw good performance from Alexandra Michael, and Sumaraj beaten for 4 times. We'll look at this match. A couple of mistakes from her that I don't think she'll relish too much. All the smiles will come, I think, from the TUT side, who scored through Sepati Matiba, who scored a brace in Mashilo Mbatle and Mbatle for UP Tux. The victory to the Tshwane University of Technology. 6 goals in the encounter. It all started just before halftime. It was Rakudue. Nice little turn from Mashilwana. Eventually the ball pops up here from the edge of the penalty area. The clearance from Morris. A little chip from Sibati. It's brilliant.
It's a beautiful ball. Definitely. She just picked a spot after the ball was lost. And then she just looked at the keeper once. And then she whipped it above the keeper. It was a beautiful goal.
So 1-0 TUT leading at half-time into the second half of the encounter. And more goals to come. In fact, this looks as if it's a repeat of the first goal. Yes, it is. Sabati grabbing that goal. We'll have a look at it from yet another angle. And the first time that Sumaraj was beaten, she was beaten 4 times in the encounter, twice by the same player in Madiba, who was denied a hat-trick because she was replaced. The coach not looking too happy with the situation. She has another opportunity for TUT to go further in front, and Matiba grabbing the first of her 2 goals from the edge of the penalty area, timing it to perfection.
It was a very beautiful ball from Rachel Sibati, and then Matiba just took that trip and tapped it in.
So 6 goals in it. There's the tail of the tape. 33 goal attempts, 22 on target, and 58% of the possession tells the story. TUT with the 4 goals, the 3 points. Now they've had a good day here in the Potchefstroom this afternoon. This is where all the attacks came from. 25% down the left-hand side, 23% on the right, 50% down the middle of the park. 56 attacks from TUT, and they were worthy of the 3 points today.
Well, certainly a very important and rather impressive victory for the Tshwane University of Technology. First up here in Potchefstroom, 4-2 winners over their rivals from the University of Pretoria. And well, a very good performance from the lady standing next to me. She is FNB Woman of the Match, Koketso Tlailane. And congratulations for being Man of the Match. You win yourself R1,000 courtesy of FNB. And the handover being done by Willem Meyer, who is, of course, the branch manager for FNB Potchefstroom. Koketso, do come closer once you have time. Thank you very much for joining me. A very good performance from you, a very good win, not only over the University of Pretoria, but also to set down a bit of a marker as far as the competition is concerned.
Well, congratulations to TUT, obviously, and I mean, we've been working hard for this. You know, I mean, we could have scored more goals and we created more chances. And I must say that I'm proud of the team. We played very well. And yeah, I mean, for the upcoming games, I guess everybody's just looking at us. So yeah, everyone's going to be gunning for us. So I guess we have to work hard and just get ready for them.
Do you guys believe that you've got the ability and the fortitude to deal with the pressure that's going to come?
Well, for now, I can say that so far, so good. And I think we can. It's just that we just need to focus and not focus on the fact that we won today's game. That doesn't mean that we're going to win the whole tournament. So we just need to focus on the upcoming game so that we can actually do very well.
Well, congratulations for winning. You certainly have laid down a bit of a marker. And hopefully we'll see you guys in the final come the 22nd of September.
Thank you very much. Hope so too.
That is the FNB Woman of the Match this evening. A very good performance from herself. Really a very good performance from the Tshwane University of Technology as a whole. And I'm sure a lady who will be very happy with how her team has fared here today is the skipper. Thank you very much for joining me. Your thoughts on the whole game?
It wasn't really an easy game. They were tough on us. They were hard. They were like soldiers. And we just had to keep up with the game and play according to the instructions.
What were those instructions, especially at halftime when you had created a lot of chances but had only 1 goal to show for it?
We had to relax on the ball, play it, share the ball as a team and not rush. That was it.
Now the second half, the Tux showed exactly what they are about in coming back, and it seemed as if they were coming back and they're going to draw level, but you guys made sure that you stayed ahead with that fourth goal.
Well, we had to relax because they were putting pressure on us, and like I thought we were losing focus at some point, and I had to tell my players, no guys, come on, it's nothing, we can do this, let's relax and play our football. Yeah.
Well, you certainly did it, 4-2 winners in the end, and we're certainly looking forward to seeing exactly what you guys are able to bring up as far as next the next two games you're going to be playing are concerned. Two tough games coming up tomorrow as well before we get to Saturday's action.
Oh yes, and we're looking forward to the semi-finals. We don't know who we're going to meet there, we're just expecting a team.
Right, congratulations for the win.
Thank you very much.
That is the winning skipper here this afternoon of the 20 University of Technology. Really happy with how her team has played, 4-2 winners in the end. Well, there's still one more match to come live on your World of Champions this afternoon. Kickoff from 6:30. It's the University of the Western Cape, defeated finalists, of course, from last season. They're up against the home side, the Northwest University Bucca campus. And speaking of the Northwest University, I'm going to be joined now by the coach from the home side, and her name, Belinda Ngosi. And coach, thank you very much for joining me. And what are you looking forward to, not only from your side as far as today's action is concerned, but also from the whole weekend?
I think it's going to be very fun, and we'll see very quality football. And I think everybody's ready. Everybody looks ready. It's going to be quite exciting, actually.
Now, we don't know too much about your side. We do know that they made it to the quarterfinals at the USA Championships, which in itself is a very good performance. What can we expect from Northwest University?
They're hard workers and they don't give up, and they just want to play. They just want to play, and that's exactly what we're going to do.
And speaking of playing, how have you instructed them to play against a very good UWC side?
We know that they love playing the ball around a lot, and especially they love camping in our own half. So we're going to try to catch them with their counter-attack.
Well, hopefully that does work out for you. We're looking forward to seeing what your charges have in store for us. All the best.
Okay, thank you, thank you.
That is the coach of the home side, the Northwest University, Belinda Ngosi, talking about the fact that they're looking forward to playing on the counter-attack against a very strong UWC side. And the coach of that UWC side right next to me right now, Alan Thew. Alan, thank you very much for joining me. And it's going to be a tough game, but as far as the format is concerned, it's very different to what we know as far as women's football and varsity football is concerned. Your thoughts on the whole new change in format?
Well, it certainly is an opportunity to showcase ladies football on a bigger platform, and that's ultimately what we're here to do, you know, to grow the image and status of women's football.
Let's talk about your side. We know exactly what they are capable of. Made it to the final last year. A couple of really big names as well as far as the team is concerned. A couple of under 20 players, national team players as well, and Banyana players as well. That comes with a fair bit of pressure. Are you guys able to, do you think you guys are able to deal with that, not only today, but also obviously in what's to come as far as the tournament is concerned?
Yeah, I mean, we've got those players, and I don't think there's any amount of pressure on us because we have those players. I think all the girls are in it to do the best that they can, whether they're under 20 national players or not. We have a squad system, and any of them could play on any given day or not. So no pressure. We've come, the girls must enjoy themselves and showcase their ability, because they have.
Well, they certainly do have plenty of ability. Hopefully it all comes together for the University of the Western Cape, and we'll see exactly what your team has in store for us.
Thank you very much.
That is the coach of the University of the Western Cape. Speaking about the fact that they've got the players, can they, though, put it all together and get an opening victory in a Group A here in Potchefstroom? We'll take a short break, and when we come back, it's going to be a kickoff between the UWC. They're up against the home side, the Northwest University Bucca campus.